I am well, thank God, and in high spirits. I am now on an expedition to the westward with Captain Lewis and Captain Clark, who are appointed by the President of the United States to go on an expedition through the interior parts of North America. We are to ascend the Missouri River with a boat as far as it is navigable, and then go by land to the Western Ocean, if nothing prevents.
If nothing prevents, the story of Camp River Du Bois turns on this simple phrase. For white explorers, actual knowledge of the Northwest was as fragmented as the frontier itself, a patchwork of places known and unknown, and enough of each to inspire fear and imagination.
The best authenticated accounts informed us that we were to pass through a country possessed by numerous, powerful, and warlike nations. Fierce, treacherous.
It is not improbable that this voyage of discovery will procure us further information of the mammoth and of the megatherium also. Mentioned by you.
Speculation about what the expedition would find ranged from the reasonable to the fantastic. Volcanoes, Welsh Indians, Great Salt Mountains. But one discovery would be prized above all else.
If your nation could establish an easy communication route by river between New York and the mouth of the Columbia, what a route that would be for trade from Europe, from Asia, and from America, whose northern products were...
President Thomas Jefferson had long believed the United States should explore the Northwest. His political enemies were against it. Other countries were vying for control of the territory. Jefferson pressed forward with a plan.
An intelligent officer with 10 or 12 chosen men might explore the whole line, even to the Western Ocean. Have conference with the natives.
Congress bought his plan. The president hoped to find an easy route to the Pacific. The currents of great rivers run deep with lore. They have been seen as ancient spirits, as passages to the next life, as portals into mystery. Rivers have the power to sustain life, to destroy it, to carry it to new places. Thus, the course of history so often follows the course of great rivers. And forces of change often converge where great rivers meet.
The Missouri, which mouths immediately opposite me, is the river we intend ascending as soon as the weather will permit. This great river, which seems to dispute the preeminence of the Mississippi, comes in at right angles from the west and forces its great sheets of muddy ice against the eastern bank. We are collecting the...
Near this great convergence on the eastern side of the Mississippi, the expedition party spent the winter camped on a small stream called Rivière du Bois, or Wood River. Clark established military order and began to prepare for the first leg of the journey. That winter, as the river rolled, swirling down from distant places, did they imagine perils upriver that could prevent the success of their journey, or even end their lives? The convergence of rivers in the area created a natural hub for trade, drawing together people of many different cultures. You might say the whole world passed through this place. Fortunes could be made on the frontier. Goods came from the East Coast in Europe and then streamed out in all directions to settlers and Native Americans. Cahokia and St. Louis thrived on the business. Lewis and Clark arrived in St. Louis in December of 1803. The treaty for the Louisiana Purchase had been made 6 months earlier, but had not yet been formalized. Spain traded the territory to France, and France sold it to the United States. But the Spanish governor who remained in control refused Lewis access to the territory. No one consulted the Native Americans who lived in the territory.
Lieutenant Governor De La Sue concluded by observing that, whatever his feelings as a man, his duty as an officer forbade him granting me permission to ascend the Missouri River. And finally, as a friend, advised my remaining at Cahokia until the next spring, alleging that by that time...
Cahokia residents Nicholas Giroux and John Hay acted as translators for Lewis. Giroux may have suggested the location of a winter campsite upstream from Cahokia. Thus, the future of the West and the world became linked to a small encampment on Wood River. At Camp River Dubois, men could see boats moving up and down the rivers. Did their thoughts follow these vessels out? The men still watched and wondered, what stories make these waters one day? President Jefferson wanted more from the expedition than a water passage to the West. He wanted American control of the West. He also wanted scientific information, details about the land, its people, plants, and animals. Success on all these different fronts at once would require a special kind of leader, one with a broad range of knowledge in the natural sciences, an understanding of Native American ways, and highly developed wilderness survival skills. Jefferson found many of these abilities in a young Virginian he'd watched grow up and who had become his personal secretary, Meriwether Lewis. Captain Lewis, in turn, wrote William Clark, a friend and seasoned officer under whom he had served in the regular army.
If there is anything in this enterprise which would induce you to participate with me in its fatigues, its dangers, and its honors, believe me, there is no man on earth with whom I should feel equal pleasure in sharing them as with yourself. I make this communication with you.
My friend, I do assure you that no man lives with whom I prefer to undertake such a trip as yourself, and I shall arrange my matters as well as I can.
Clark accepted the invitation. Lewis made him co-commander, equal in every respect, and they began to gather recruits. Clark refused several young volunteers. Gentlemen's sons, he noted, and not accustomed to labor. Those selected would be crucial to the outcome of the mission. Lewis traveled down the Ohio River from Pittsburgh in a keelboat especially built for the expedition. He arrived in Louisville with two trial recruits and his dog, Seaman. Clark was waiting with his slave, York, and nine young men from Kentucky. Further west, they selected soldiers from the ranks at Fort Massac and at Kaskaskia, and continued to gather men even at Camp River Dubois. Most were in their early 20s and unmarried. Only a few were educated. Patrick Gass was a carpenter and boat builder. John Shields was a blacksmith and gunsmith. Others specialized as cooks or boatmen. George Drouillard was an interpreter and also an expert woodsman and hunter. all had practical experience on the frontier. Camp River Du Bois is where they came to know one another and began to prepare in earnest for what lay ahead. For much of the winter, Lewis stayed in Cahokia and St. Louis, preparing for the journey. He spoke to traders who'd been upriver, deep into native territory. He gathered maps, information, and journals about the West. And he provided a steady stream of vital intelligence and supplies to Camp River Du Bois. Captain Clark wintered with the men.
Fixed on a place to build huts, set the men to clearing land and cutting logs, a hard wind all day.
The tedium of hard work was relieved by visits and trading with passing boatmen, native peoples, and local residents.
A pirogue came, a Mr. Samuel Griffith, a good farmer who lives 9 miles up the Missouri, and a Mr. Gilbert. Three Indians came today to take Christmas with us. I gave them a bottle of whiskey.
But the winter was long. The men were often restless.
I issued certain orders and prohibited a certain Ramey from selling liquor to the party. Several men come from the country to see us and shoot with the men. I put up a dollar to be shot for. The country people won the dollar. 7 or 8 men intoxicated from the whiskey they received on the way. Warner and Potts fight after dark without my knowledge. I ordered those men who had fought, got drunk, and neglected duty to go and build a hut for a woman. Wednesday, 28th. All hands at work preparing for the voyage up the Missouri.
In early spring, preparations intensified. The keelboat and 2 pirogues required modifications to handle the necessary supplies and arms.
Wednesday, the 4th. All day packing provision. Settled account with the contract. Making a mast and packing pork today. The after part of the day. Load the boat and 1 pirogue today. Manned her with 20 oars and went the middle of the river and up the Mississippi. Several of the country people in camp shooting with the party. All get beat and lose their money.
By May 14th, 1804, the individual lives of the men had begun to converge into one, a unit. But how could they know if they were really prepared? If nothing prevents, Sergeant Ordway wrote, the journey would confirm he had good reason to wonder. Camp River Du Bois no longer stands, but this place connects us to the kind of moment that shapes the future of a nation. The moment when individuals stand at journey's edge and choose to go beyond the boundaries of what they know, to test themselves against what they do not. We all face such moments, as did the men at Camp River Du Bois, and as our nation did in the spring of 1804.
Time and place where I receive my discharge, and if I should not live to return, my heirs can get all the pay due me from the U.S. by applying to the seat of government. I have read no letters since Betsy's yet, but will write next winter if I have a chance. Yours, etc., John Ordway, Sergeant. Thank you.